Good evening and welcome to the November meeting of the Recreation and Parks Board. We will go ahead and call the meeting to order and start off by introducing the board members. Start with you, Nick.
I'm Nick Colvin.
Caroline King.
Pat Murphy.
Fred Parker.
Dick Buckler.
Doug Bellis.
Jill Longobardi.
And the first order of business is a review and approval of the minutes from October 4th. Does anyone have comments, questions on those? If all good, we will take a motion to approve those.
I move to approve.
Second?
I second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Minutes approved unanimously. We will move right along to a presentation on capital improvement projects with Mr. Shepherd.
Oh, thank you and good evening. We have four of those highlighted there. That's the parks, facilities, and park improvements. Let me get that straight. I want to go over that with you and review that. I'm not looking for any action tonight as much as I'm just looking, once again, discussion. This is early in the budget process and working this out with the commissioners, but I want to hear from you, plus extend to you this information. Then I want to review again the Lexington Manor project that we've heard about the last two meetings and tell you what the status is with the county commissioners. Review once again the multi-use game plan, be brief there. And then lastly, you see as part of the capital project is our three-notch trail in phase seven. And I think that Mr. Parker may be having a motion regarding a proposed memorial there on the trail. And we discussed last time in memory of Mr. Jim Swift. So on the one sheet, a handout that you have there that says recreation facilities and park improvements on a two-sided piece of paper. In the capital improvement, does everybody have that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
In the capital improvement projects, one of those line item accounts is called recreation facilities and park improvements. And in the past few years, if you can see, if you go down to the center bottom of the page, about 1.2, 1.3, close to 1.4 million has been spent in that area. These are the improvements that go for air conditioning, doors, roofs, painting, asphalt overlay, tennis court lights improvements, golf course, and all those items. So in 2020, going into the year through the FY19 budget, the plan was about $1.2 million worth of improvements. And you can see those labeled out, how we get to that total of 1.2. And then in your right-hand line, you see $100,000 in parentheses. We've reduced that cost at Town Creek because that's already been, project's been done, correct, David? And some of it's been funded through insurance because of the weather storm. So that's what that means. That's why it's gone from 1.29 million to $1,190,000. So what I'm asking you, that was in our FY19 as you go for the out years. We're going to leave that in as my proposal right now. Then here's some proposed additions. What are we going to do now to complete this and bring to the Board of County Commissioners, which will result in about 1.7 million. And I'll speak to that very briefly. So Cardinal Gibbons tennis courts, we're going to have to finish those up in 2020 instead of 19, so an additional 39,000. We're looking again at a restroom at Dorsey Park. You know, the field came along excellent. But as I spoke before, over there on the football field side, picnic pavilion side, all that, there's no restroom. You have to walk all the way over, and that's safety and convenience and all those in mind. So we have a price tag there for a restroom comparable to the existing structure we have at Dorsey. Great Mills Pool needs a new air conditioning unit, and also pool deck refurbishment. What that means in the last 14 years, there's stainage, there's cracks that need to be sealed, and we've gotten some prices, and to get that up to spec, it's going to be about at a $30,000 price tag, but much needed. Hollywood Recreation Center, we just had needs and restroom renovation project. You know, that's an old school, and we just excellent progress there at Carver Recreation Center. David wants to take care of the bathrooms, the existing ones at Lancaster, Bagot, and Chancellor's Run, to need those improvements. Then as you see one of those items, park and three-notch trail overlay, I want to put an additional $100,000 in there. Because what's happening is, I think I said this a couple meetings ago, with the trail, 11 miles of trail, and you're doing a quarter mile to a half a mile per time, it doesn't take much to do that. So we have to have this as a continuum, just like a playground over. And then lastly, some additional improvements at Wycomico with the bunker project and the cart path project to bring that up to that number. So that's, since we went away, since that was in FY19, you see that's about, that's right at $500,000. Puts us to that term of 1.7. I'm going to bring some summary to it now. So in FY17, 1.4 million. FY 2020, 1.7 million. That's a $300,000 increase. What is that all about? Why that? Because that's money. But percentage wise, about 21%. But here's the reality. In 17, we still, there wasn't, Wycomico wasn't in the CIP at the time. Your plan for keeping this trail, you see that kind of money to keep that in proper shape with the asphalt overlay. That's in there now. Some of the other areas that we possibly were behind, you could that we get, is it's going to get us there. We can possibly maybe take some of these and negotiate, say it doesn't need and maybe move out, but really we're just paying later. So what I'll do is work it out with the commissioners, see where the money is for all the big picture CIP items too. What we do here tonight, I want to answer any of your questions what we have, but the main thing as we go through the process is to, let's say, as we begin to make the adjustments with the commissioners and we start targeting some priority listings, then we'll be talking about that. Okay, here we go, we got to get this down to 1.3 million. What do you think of our priorities with the director's input? Is that fair? So that's all this is it's early, just want to keep you involved early instead of at the midnight hour saying what are we going to do. And so anybody have any questions or thoughts? And then plus two, we'll invite yours. If not tonight, to invite you through a email or a conversation about some of your thoughts that maybe could be put in here for the next time.
I have one thought. I love to see that we're doing improvements to restrooms. Mm-hmm. And I like the idea of a second restroom facility at Dorsey Park. What about, have you considered doing that at Chancellor's Run? Because that's quite a distance too to get from some of those soccer fields over to the main building where the restrooms are. I don't know if there's space for it there. That might be a consideration, but.
Well, I'm including those in the notes. Mm-hmm.
That's something I hear all the time.
Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts?
Is the asphalt overlay, does that to cover the whole overlay of the existing trail? Is that, or is that?
Yeah, I can answer, but go ahead and speak to it, David.
Not the total length. It's various sections that are deteriorate over a period of time because of tree roots and wear and tear and that type of thing. So, no, it would not do the whole trail at any one time.
Okay. So general repairs that need.
Yeah, and some, see, because that's where I think we have to have a plan, too, because some of it, to me, is going to be periodic. In other words, it needs it, even though it doesn't, you know, it's been 8 years and it needs an overlay, it needs recondition. And some of it is because of roots, freeze, thaw, carts on the trail, different means. Because how much, what was it, 60,000 up there this past year?
Yeah, about that, yeah.
60,000, and what was that, a linear footage, a quarter mile?
That's in the ballpark, yeah.
Okay.
So you see, you know, and if you're doing quarter miles or half miles at a time, it's yeah. But that's our trail. That's, oh, and speaking of our trail, let me, I should wait to the projects, but I can't, I got to get out. Kathy and I did attend the kickoff meeting for that $4.1 million, very excited. We're going to have a nice trail, and it's going to, and knowing that funding's available and meeting those people myself, and especially now that I'm on my own, I have to learn hard, and they tried to whip me into shape early, but that was a good meeting up in Baltimore with SHA and TAPS and Bikeway, so. Very proud to be there that day and represent you guys in the community. Okay, that sounds good, and I'll keep you informed and abreast of that. Thank you much. Then I have this PowerPoint. Remember we viewed the PowerPoint the last time we were together? So instead of viewing that again, I just took the excerpts of it, the main things, and just want to go over it with you one more time so that stays. We don't meet but so often, so I want to keep you educated and understanding and questions you have in the aftermath. And let's say if we can go to that first page where it says Lexington Manor Concept Planning. And again, this is still part of presentation to our community. They can hear this about, we're talking about that northern parcel up there on Coral Drive, right off of Great Mills Road next to Gate 2 of the base. That's the Lexington Park northern, Lexington Manor northern parcel. So you see the four things. The development district approved the use of the property as public open space. The commissioner said while the county retains the right to develop the property for commercial use, we foresee not doing so. Third, the LPPRP that was just approved cites this as being a recommendation to repair and enhance the trails and the old streets in the Lancaster Park south and north parcels. And finally, we told them, the commissioners, that we briefed you and you concurred with moving forward. And you can see on the next page is the map of the site. And I put that there in case there were some questions. Then as you can see on page 3 for everybody, remember here's the outcome. Here's the outcome. Once again, just to keep you included, the vision from the planning meetings. Remember, clear sight lines. So when they're, pull that brush up so we can see through the property. Open it up. Lighted bicycle trail from Shangri-La Drive over to Lay Drive, which is right there next to Three Oaks Center, that can get you to Gate 2 of the base. Improve the conditions of the roads and walking paths, improve the conditions of the open space grass, more cuts, minimize the vehicular traffic, and really use Lancaster Park as the entrance into there. And then the other things as far as programming. So as I sat here and had the same overview with the commissioners, everybody now is, okay, we're delighted. Something's gonna, you know, the property's gonna be passive, low impact, we're in the fly zone, but yet we're going to make some improvements there. So really what we agreed, that all of this would be worked out in the budget process. Because who knows, this might be as we go forward, is okay, Arthur, here you have this plan, but how are we going to pay for it? Well, then why can't we get that in the 20, 21, 22 CIP budget that asks for all those things? We can move it fast or slow. But that's where it's going to be worked out. Now let me finish up on that back page, though. The proposed timeline. You go to the third bullet, meeting with additional partners and stakeholders. Said we're going to do that so in October, November. So here we are, 1st of November. I'll be sending that out. I'd like to have one meeting before the new year, before the holidays, so that the stakeholders would have the information, because it's getting out there. And Mr. Murphy on our board here has agreed to be on that, represent the board with that group. Because if you look at the below there, the stakeholders, the Navy, Economic Development, Arts Council, Three Oaks Shelter, Three Notch Theater, law enforcement, first responder, businesses, churches right in that community. And we're going to bring them together so that everybody, one, can be ambassadors for the project, understand what's going there, and then can also be proponents of the project. So the last one is the MPO, you look on that number one bullet on proposed timeline, Calvert St. Mary's MPO concept plan bid due October 1st. Well, the bids have come back. They've been evaluated, and I don't know yet, but it's soon to be awarded. And it looks like it'll be going forth in, sometime in the new year. So that will give some information I can bring to you, the commissioners, of, hey, what's some of the priorities of this piece of property? So that's where we are. Just wanted to keep you abreast, keep you educated, so you can have your questions regarding that. Any questions on there, Ms. Chandler? So this group is still ready to move forward. I'm looking forward to working with Mr. Murphy on it and getting him dug in on this. This is going to be a good project. This is going to be a good project. It really is. I'm excited about it and what it means to Lexington Park and our park space there. Matter of fact, when I was coming up from south to north on 235, right there outside of Easternell, what used to be Easternell, looking over there, just Tuesday night, there's 8 joggers jogging the south parcel where the disc golf course. So that vision just came right there, and that once all that impervious surface improved, opened up, not for vehicular traffic, for joggers, walkers, non-motorized wheels, nice passive area there to adjoin with Lancaster Park. Okay.
Sounds great.
Multi-purpose game field plan. All right, I told you, I sent out a status memorandum to the commissioners, exactly what you know. So everybody, what do we all know? I'm working on a game field plan that addresses our current game field situation. You know what that means, that we said at the last meeting that there were some fields wanted additional cuts. We know that a game field needs water. We know that a game field, so it needs irrigation. We're liking what happened at Dorsey with the Bermuda. If you haven't been, that was an incredible job that David and the group did with there, and then plus the weather cooperating when we didn't think it was. So if we can get several fields of that in that shape, some lit, and I'm looking to do it at a cost neutral, where that we use some of the CIP funds that were designated but not allocated for Chaptico Park, to use that to get us up to spec with the game fields. Because what that's going to do is, since I met with you last, I've been in conversation with Maryland Stadium Authority. You all aware of who they are? They do projects around the state, sports complex projects, plus big venue projects. They have, looks like we're going to be able to piggyback their person that does their feasibility study, Crossroads. I've been on the phone with them since I met with you last. But the sports complex said that we have a feasibility study right now in FY19. Well, that, the first thing they come out is, well, the number one piece is impact. Are you going to be able to get your money back? Do you have the restaurants, hotels, and are you going to be able to attract the groups to come in? Because one of the issues we have to find out is, they talk about saturation. We're not the first to come up with the idea of sports complex, and there's a lot of tournaments. Are you going to be able to get them? And then what is going to be your organizational management plan? But let me get back to my point. But my point was, if we get other game fields in shape, you take this hub of sports complex with them auxiliary fields in game shape, that heightens your abilities to have more in your tournaments. So we will have even a return of investment on these recreational game fields. All right, I've talked a lot here. So any questions? Yes. So the game fields are still moving forward, but probably, and hopefully when we'll be having discussions in January regarding the CIP. The first, let me give you the schedule of the CIP. You know there's an election next week. y'all know that, right? Yeah. Nick, you know that, right?
Oh, yeah.
So there's an election next week, and then there's a swearing in. But, you know, Tuesday, December the 4th, when the new board comes along, that very first Tuesday, they will be setting the schedule for the capital improvement project schedule. So you'll take all these things and say, okay, let's reroute, let's stay. Mr. Shepherd, why do you think this is important? How do you plan on? What's the plan? What's the out-year plan? And all those discussions are going to be happening. Or they might not ask us a thing. The commissioners then just set their priorities, and then we go from there. So that's why I keep you abreast, because then we come back and talking about priorities. Then I need to ask you your thoughts, your concurrences, what you think, so that I can bring to the commissioners with where are you thinking. And tonight's just not a night where we're having concurrences. This is more just more education, keeping the information in front of you, so that when we do it, when it is time, you feel like you've heard enough of what's going on. And then also feel free to, but the big one is, feel free to call me too or email me to get some of these questions too, so that you're very well briefed on this information. Mr. Bellis, you have enough information there?
I think so.
Thank you all for y'all's patience with me and attention. Y'all are so gracious to me. I appreciate that. So I'm going to turn it over now to Mr. Parker regarding Trail 7 and some discussion and a potential motion regarding a memorial.
Yeah, I'd like to move to place a memorial bench in Jim Swift's name. That's all we know. He passed away from cancer a couple of years ago. And I'd like to do it somewhere within the Willows area that's under development right now.
Okay.
And I'll work with the development team for a specific location. I don't want to designate that now and lock us into something. But I think we should do something for Jim Swift.
Ms. Chairman? And then also I do want to say from the staff side that Recreation Parks, there is a vehicle to have memorials at different sites, whether they're in a park or a county setting, and this would be one of them. A memorial bench would fit that, Mr. Swift, and we can move forward that and take your recommendation and do that. And I like Mr. Parker's idea of, we're about 40% in the design, as if somebody from the board with him in particular working with staff to find the appropriate site, and then we can move forward instead of having to discuss a specific site tonight, that you would trust him to work with staff to get an appropriate site along the trail.
Okay. So the motion would be to recommend to Recreation and Parks that this memorial be placed and that you will work with them to determine exactly.
Location.
Okay. Is there a second for that motion?
I'll second that.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, motion carries.
Oh, excellent. Excellent, and I appreciate that. And then we'll look to, and then we'll also, I would like to even and didn't form a motion, but look at ways that people could support that through different means, through a promotion, through finance or whatever. So that we all, you know, as a group, as a community, and Pax Velo and different groups, Mr. Parker, that can do that and be a part of this in a big way instead of just, you know, a puff. So just, right. Let's get the promotion for the trail and Mr. Swift at the same time. What do you think of that?
Oh, I agree.
Okay.
Very good. All right, if there's nothing else on that, we can move along to the staff recognition.
Yeah, Ms. Hale, is she here with us? I know she was doing an incredible amount of work outside, getting it organized and getting people in and greeting our hourly. But I'm going to surprise you and tell you I have something I'm going to say. The reason, and I appreciate Jessica here, I don't know who's behind me now, but I saw him coming in. You know, a lot that you'll see in this room tonight has been with us for a very long time. The hourly employee in Recreation and Parks is, that's our backbone, to be honest. We have some 40 full-time people, but well, in the hundreds of hourly employees, when you talk about before and after childcare, summer camps, pool setting, gymnastic center, the waterfront park business now having the staff in the parks, all hourly employees. Now, most of hourly employees, you remember, think about the kind of hours when most hourly employees are getting it done, weekends, evenings, to make sure that our community can have leisure opportunities and a time for positive youth development for their children. So what does it take? Hundreds that are dedicated, hundreds that stay with you, hundreds that love children, hundreds that are committed to positive youth development. It's incredible for me to really think about the length of time some of these have served. So what you're going to see tonight, you're going to have length of service, plus you'll also see some specialty awards that we came up with. I don't know where they came up with them, so, you know, just let it play out. Just let it play out, and we're going to have a good time in here tonight. Jessica, are you ready to get us started? So she's coming up, and as she's coming up, the board members, if you'll come out on the front and be a part of the congratulatory line, I'd appreciate that.
This might be on. I think we're good. Good evening. Thank you so much for everybody for being here. This is the second year that we are taking an opportunity to recognize our hourly staff for their contributions as well as their length of service with our department. So thank you, board members, for allowing us to do this. We have quite a few here tonight, so we'll go ahead and get started. Each year, the department relies almost entirely on the dedication and hard work provided by hundreds of hourly employees offering quality recreation programs to the citizens of St. Mary's County. Their talent and passion fuels creative and life-enhancing activities for all ages, young and old. Tonight, we are recognizing 39 individuals who have given us either more than 10 years of dedicated service, or we've decided to name you some all-stars for 2018. So thank you so much for being here. And many of you have talents over multiple areas, including sports, youth development, therapeutic, aquatics, facility maintenance, school-age care, and summer camps. However, work rarely pauses for our staff, so many of them cannot be here tonight because they're currently working in the field providing services for our citizens. Those that were able to make it will call you up by your program area in which you'll accept a certificate from your respective supervisor, Mr. Shepherd, our director, and the board members. And then we'll follow each group that we call up with a photo. All right, so we're gonna start with school age care and summer camp programs. I'd like to bring up our program coordinator, Sherry Nelson. And the following staff are going to be recognized for their dedication and their years of service. And the first one is a duo. Sherry would like to recognize and name the 2018 Best Double Dutch Duo to Vontae Day and Rashad Goldring. Completing the Double Dutch Challenge with Summer Camp Kids. Thank you for your enthusiasm and dedication to make camp fun for all children. The next staff we'd like to recognize is Carol Daniel. Carol's being awarded the 2018 Glow Stick Award for her shining and glowing personality that brightens everyone's day. Thank you for your enthusiasm. The last one present for this category, Samantha Fisher. We would like to recognize her for setting the example and being named 2018's Miss Fitness Award. Samantha hits the gym more often than anyone else combined and sets an example for health and wellness for staff and participants. And there was an edit. The next person that actually did make it tonight is Samantha Raley, and Samantha is being recognized as Rookie of the Year Award for summer camp program. Samantha is receiving this for the numerous comments we received from parents, for her enthusiasm and ability to relate to children in a positive way. Thank you for creating a fun, safe place for children during the summer. So congratulations to our summer camp display chair. Those not present this evening are Bernadette Day. Bernadette's being recognized as a single file sergeant award for keeping staff and campers in line and always looking out for others and making sure everyone's taken care of. And finally, Roxanne Campos is being awarded the fourth and long award for most likely to come through with the clutch play. Always there to help in a key play situations, and she's receiving her certificate for 10 years of service to youth programs. Thank you for your dedication. We can do a photo now.
Right in front of the table. Okay, board members, y'all come up. Let me see. Make sure you kind of get in a gap of somebody. Gap. Thank you.
Next, I would like to recognize our therapeutic recreation programs and welcome Christina Bishop, our program coordinator. And the following staff are being recognized for their dedication and years of service. Leanna Davis. Leanna is receiving the 2018 TR Champion Award for working hard to ensure all children of all abilities are able to enjoy the benefits of recreation and parks. You do so with determination and care. The next award is another duo. We have Ernestine Pence and Lindsay Robeson, who are being recognized as the dynamic duo for working together to develop a team made in heaven, always in sync and providing exceptional support for children with special needs.
Very nice.
Finally, Dana Gregory, who couldn't join us tonight, is being recognized as the TR Rookie of the Year for providing exceptional nursing services to summer camp participants with the biggest smile around. You're always such a light through your care and empathy for all, a true gem.
Board, I trust you've got this down this
time. Yeah, I think we do, yeah.
Okay, representing our gymnastics program with us tonight is Derek Sesker, program coordinator, and the following staff are being recognized for their dedication to gymnastics programs. Joseph Gordon. Joseph Gordon is receiving the Mr. Clean Award for taking meticulous care of the Gymnastics Center each week and ensuring participants and staff enjoy a clean facility. I do not believe Joseph made it. Next being recognized is Marva Jones as the Gymnastics Rookie of the Year for developing a positive environment for all gymnastics coaches, staff, parents, and athletes. Your leadership is valued, and the gym is a better place because of your hard work. Next is Lindsay Trainum, who has earned the Team Player Award for always being willing to assist where needed without complaint, always looking for a way to make the workplace fun while keeping others in mind and completing tasks. And finally, Sue Lynch, who is receiving recognition tonight for over 15 years of service to Recreation and Parks at the Gymnastics Center. Thank you for your many years of dedicated service and passion for the sport. And that is our gymnastics group.
Gymnastics? What an incredible program. Thank you for what you do.
Same thing this time, Mark?
Just making sure.
Representing the Great Mills Pool and Aquatics programs with us tonight is Gary Reed, Program Coordinator. We are providing special recognition tonight for Simon Thomas as the 2018 Aquatics Rookie of the Year for setting an exceptional example for a true hard worker committed to making the pool a better place to visit, for always going above and beyond and never hesitating to lend a hand. Yeah. Next is Mary Lou Dove as a 2018 Enthusiasm Award winner for always being eager and willing to help regardless of time or request and always guaranteed for a smile and a laugh.
Very nice.
And next.
I'll give it Gary.
All right.
And next to be recognized is Miss Viola Jones for her work at the Carver Recreation Center as the Jack of All Trades Award. She does it all. Always willing to assist.
Viola, you rock, girl.
Always willing to assist, providing ideas for improvement, and filling in when and whenever wherever needed. You're truly an advocate for recreation and parks.
Yes.
Okay. Representing youth and adult sports programs with us tonight is Kenny Southern, the program coordinator.
52 years.
The first award goes to George Stewart for the Character Award this year for truly understanding and exemplifying what recreation sports is all about. Thank you for setting the bar high for how participants and spectators should handle sports. Yeah. Next, we recognize Eugene Butler with the 2018 Enthusiasm Award for radiating joy and smiling, ready to take on any task. His passion for youth sports is contagious, and children flourish under his guidance. Biddy Basketball is your success.
Gene hired me.
Next is 2018's Loyalty Award, which is going to be given to Roy Stamm for being a fixture in youth and adult indoor soccer. State lines couldn't stop him from contributing to the success and organization for hundreds of participants, and he came back. He truly is in it for the love of the game, not the money. And the following staff within the sports programs have given over 10 years of service. Tonight we recognize Jonathan Pease.
Jonathan.
Come on, Jonathan.
Russell Murray. So good to be here tonight. Joseph Zip Douglas. Ray Abad, I do not believe made it tonight. And that is it for the 10-year for the sports. Unfortunately, Joseph Burrows and David Jarbo were unable to attend, but combined they have provided over 30 years of service to the department sports programs. We thank them for their service. And finally, we recognize Bob Richardson for over 20 years of service to the sports programs. He always has a smile, ready for work, to tell a good story and lend a hand. Thank you for your dedication. Unfortunately, I don't believe he made it tonight. Had to work. So that does it for our sports group.
Seen. Doug, you're in trouble, Doug.
Doug, you want to get on my shoulders?
Yeah.
I apologize, there was a last minute addition, so. I would also like to recognize Joseph Norris, who has worked in several of our programs and has helped with the parks programs, for his 10 plus years of service. I'd like to recognize the rest of our park staff who many at this moment are working to keep our parks clean and safe. These individuals work in all weather and give tirelessly their dedication and attention to ensuring citizens experience everything outdoors in St. Mary's County, all under the supervision of Mr. Tyrone Harris.
JT.
Tammy Gillingham has earned the 2018 Most Dependable Award for being a total rock star. She's behind the scenes, backbone to Parks operation and how Tyrone survives, and we would be lost without her dedication and willingness to do whatever it takes to get the job done. Her better half, Mr. Mark Gillingham, is the recipient of the Mr. All Around Award for making parks great and contributing to whatever needs there are to be met. Your passion and enthusiasm over the past 40 plus years has been instrumental to our success, and we hope he's feeling better soon. Michelle Koger is the recipient of the Miss Enthusiastic Award for demonstrating high energy every day. She brings enthusiasm to the Great Mills Pool where guests feel welcome. John McTaggart is Mr. Flexibility for being able and willing to go anywhere help is needed and do so with a smile on his face. Vicki and David Carroll have earned the 2018 Team Player Duo Award for working together as a team to get the job done. They are the definition of teamwork and an example for others. Brenda Clark is the recipient of the 2018 Most Consistent Staff for always being there to support a variety of programs. Her dedication and knowledge of a variety of programs is invaluable, and her honesty is commendable. And lastly, 2018 Mr. and Mrs. Perfection for Parks Award goes to Danielle Concordia and Joseph Bryant for always being there and always following up, keeping the supervisor informed. So congratulations to Parks.
Before we take that picture of Jay and Tyrone, I do have to take the opportunity of Jessica, thank you for an excellent evening and recognizing staff. That's a big part of it. I want to share again that without the volunteers and the hourlies, Recreation and Parks couldn't be what it is. And you know our role in a community when it comes to families, strengthening families, positive youth development, loving one another in a community. So to each one of you, thank you very much. And to the full-time staff, for you and what you do, thank you. I know what you put in your whole life to this department, and I'm very grateful on behalf of the county commissioners and the county and the Recreation Advisory Board. Thank you very, very much. Jay, come on. Thanks again. Appreciate y'all.
Okay, we are back and we will move along with project updates.
Yeah, we have a strong list here tonight. I think it's on back of one of your sheets. You have that with you. And these are the FY19 projects that David's going to update you on them briefly. And that way you'll have a status from this point on. And I hope you also, everybody gets their monthly report too that's sent out to you. Good. That's another tool that you can use to see where we are in the status. But go ahead, David, lead us through this.
Well, as you can see, we've got quite a list of projects that we're working on this year. And some of them are near completion, some are getting ready to start. We'll start with number one, the pickleball courts at the regional park that many people have been anxiously awaiting their completion, but we haven't started construction yet. Anyhow, between the design and engineering and permits and things like that, we're getting close to the end as far as that part's concerned. Next step will be a solicitation for construction of the courts. So I'm really hopeful before the end of this year that solicitation will go out, and maybe even within the next month or so. And we can begin that project down at the regional park. You'll see that Wacomico Shores Landing and Town Creek Park are getting ready to begin new playground replacements this coming Monday. very much looking forward to that. Town Creek Park tennis courts renovation. The courts are 100% complete as far as renovation is concerned, and the contractor's finishing up the fence work around those courts. So they should be usable by this coming Monday, I'm going to say. Cardinal Gibbons Park tennis court renovation. We're going to be working on that hopefully next year to get those courts. That actually, it's one court down there, renovated. Nicollet Park Skate Park, that's been a big project that's garnered a lot of interest from the skateboarders. And took a little longer than I expected to get that project complete, but we're about there right now. And the weather played a part in it, but there were some other factors also that kind of slowed the project down a little bit. But it is open for use, and we're getting some good comments and feedback on the renovations that we made. Chappaqua Park BMX track lighting. That was kind of an unexpected project that came up this year, that now the track is lit to where they can have nighttime events there. And been getting good comments on that and the appreciation for that happening. So
let me stop there, David. They are. The lights are on, and it's an incredible look with them LED lights and what they're able to do, and the fact that one of the major reasons the commissioners pushed that forward is that that has tourism behind it. State, regional, national races coming to Chappaqua. So on November 17th, they're going to have their own event night to welcome the lights in town. So I'm going to send that, when I get it, send it ahead to you. So if you would have said, hey, I feel like coming up and watch, you're welcome, is what I'm saying. You're welcome to come, stand with me, just be a part of it, have a, just celebrate with them to see. And it's going to be about 5:30 in the evening, right at the edge of dark, so they can turn the lights on, because, you know, the time's going to change. So 5:30 going to be, I'll send that to you. And if you're just, hey, I want to be a part of it, come on, and be able to celebrate with us up there at 5th District Park, there in Chappaqua Park for the BMX track. I'm excited to see it myself. I've seen videos, and I've seen pictures, still pictures, but I haven't been there, so 17th, here I come.
Okay, 5th District Park, we have a lighting project, athletic field lighting project, that we're going to get the ball rolling on that. I've got a meeting with the lighting company November 7th to determine, to talk about the project and what needs to be done. Lancaster Park field lighting project, that is ready to go. I'm told probably by the early part of December that project will start, and that will be on one of the new fields at Lancaster Park. St. Clement Shores and Great Mills Pool asphalt work. POs have been issued, just trying to wait on the contractor to when he can schedule the work to get. St. Clement Shores will be all asphalt. It's been gravel, since the time the park was built. And the pool entrance road has kind of gotten in bad shape, so we want to fix that back up. That's the idea behind that. The Interpretive Center parking lot lights, walkway, signage, design currently with Lexington Manor Improvement Plan. Arthur might want to say one or two things about that.
Well, yeah, that was part of, what we talked about before. And currently we have $75,000 we could spend in FY19. But instead of jumping out of the gate as soon as July hit, when we realized that revitalization was coming, well, how can we best spend it within that concept plan and the stakeholders and everybody meeting? And then once we see where the traffic flow is going to be there, But my main thing is really is that at Lancaster Park to get that walkway lit coming in and around the building, new signs for the disc golf course, Interpretive Center, and a pad right out in front of Interpretive. I hope $75,000 can take care of that so we can get that done soon if that's the way it works out in our concept plan.
Our next project is the Chancellor's Run Regional Park Hall of Fame building, the stairways going up to the second pavilion area, I guess you would call it. I talked to the contractor today. He is hoping to get something going by the end of this month in regards to replacing those stairways, and they've been needing to be replaced.
David, those are concrete stairs.
Yes.
So what happens? I thought concrete stairs were supposed to last forever. What happened there?
Well, I kind of used to think that myself. But they're metal frame. It's a metal frame stairway, and the treads are made out of concrete and with a metal frame around the concrete. Some people say the concrete actually speeds up the deterioration of the metal because it holds water and dampness. And so I don't know what the deal is with that, but the metal frame of the steps rusted out. Mm-hmm. And they just need to be replaced. That's the bottom line. I don't know for sure what caused it, because I'm kind of like Arthur. You would think they would last more than 20 years anyhow.
Replaced with what?
Pardon me?
Replaced with what? I mean, more of the same?
No, not the same. There'll be a metal stairway, but it won't be concrete. And we've seen that in some other areas using metal stairways, and from what I've told, that does work well.
And as you can see, that this speaks back to that my initial about the capital and parks and facility improvements. We have a lot of assets, so that's why you see that rise. And it's just, you know, things 20 years old needs to be improved. You can same thing with the Mr. Longabody here, public schools. When you have those kind of assets, there has to be that follow-up. So I'm just delighted that we have a plan going in, and I look forward to working with the commissioners and you and working it out.
That's a very good point, and obviously we're obtaining more assets as the years go by. So let's see. The St. Inigo's Landing bulkhead replacement project, which is actually a living shoreline project, that is in procurement, and hopefully we'll go for solicitation in the next few weeks to where we can, award a company to go ahead and do that project. I'm probably going to be late winter, early spring now. So I'm looking forward to get that one going. And then those replacement bleachers in our parks. We got 5 or 6 pairs of new bleachers that we've placed in various places to replace old bleachers that were well over 30 years old. And we'll probably do that from time to time with other bleachers as we see fit. Would anybody have any questions in regards to these projects?
Fifth District Lighting, is that just the new fields that you're replacing, or are you doing them all? Just asking.
There's one set of lights right now.
Yeah. There's one set of lights up there now, but
there's two sets, the football field
and the baseball.
One soccer field, the baseball field, 90, so that's 3, and then there's one set of lights when going to multi-purpose fields. And we really have, we need to sit down and confirm exactly what site work with soccer, what's going to be the best fit there.
Oh, so you're replacing the ones that are up there too?
One set of lights, new set of lights. Amazing. They're supposed to go to the multi-purpose fields
that
were just built. So that way you have, again, it's about practice time. So that, you think once next week comes, practice is minimized. And so a lot of it's already done, but we noticed that our citizens and families, they want to practice and play a little bit longer.
Those are the fields way in the back, back corner, past the baseball fields.
No, the multi-purpose field's in the front, just to the left.
To the left. The one in the way back is the football field, past the baseball field.
So if you could find it in your heart and your budget, maybe some parking lot lighting, that LED style.
Well, I was going to say, we'll be getting a price from probably SMECO to light the big parking lot there by the Bach bathroom building.
It's pretty dark.
Because we need to do something there.
Because that same, we're having that done at Chaptico.
Yeah, it seems like the lights keep out a lot of problems as well.
Yeah, that's going to happen there.
And Baggett Park looks really good with that parking lot lighting you guys put in there. It looks amazing.
Just want to keep you updated on the project so you have them before you. And then what we'll do is we'll keep this list. This list will be permanent, and then we'll just add the status to them. And that way we can send them out to you a week before the meeting so you can know exactly what's going on when you come. And then if you want a status, but that monthly report's a good tool for you to look at as well. But this will be a good status report for you. And anytime you need it and you can't find it or what's going on, call for it. We'll have it. We'll get it to you. But I think the more informed you are, the better we're off we all are as far as a team going forward on behalf of the department.
Thank you, David.
Yeah, and David, that's a lot of work.
It is. It's quite it's an aggressive agenda. Yeah. I used to use that word a lot.
You can do it. Now you got to do it next year too. We set the presidents.
And thanks both of you for keeping maintenance on there, because that's a really, years past that's been lacking. It. You guys have really stepped that up, I think.
I think we have a plan.
Good. All right, if there's nothing else on project updates, we'll move to other business. One thing I did want to mention, if everyone has met, Darlene Stalkup is here today. We didn't introduce her yet, but you're taking notes for us, so thank you for that. And it was suggested, too, that we talk about a plan for elections for officers for next year. I think we can probably hold off till December to start thinking about nominating folks, and then I believe elections are in January, if I'm not mistaken, so.
If we have a meeting in January. Last year, yeah. Because it was so close to January 1,
right.
That it was postponed to February. I think at that time,
too.
We had the election of the officers, and maybe we announced, you know, who's going to be the nomination committee in our December meeting, and that person or persons will have homework.
Sounds good.
Now, the other factor to this is we're losing two board members. You might know one of them, and Doug Ballas, and so we might have new people on the board by the time this comes around. I'm not exactly sure when the commissioners
supposed
to do it, like once a year, I think.
And, June and December, so
yeah, there's
maybe by.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we'll have new, if they know you guys are leaving.
Mm-hmm. They do.
They do.
Yep.
So that that sound okay to everyone?
Yeah.
Establish the nominating committee in December and assign them with the task of getting a slate for the, if it turns out to be the February meeting.
Very good.
I like your idea, Mr. Buckler, is that we could just have a special meeting and just move it from, because it is the third, which is close and people are gone, and we could move it just to get them going to Thursday, January the 10th for 1 week. But we can discuss that at the December meeting, to have a special meeting on January 10th, and that when we come into February, we're ready to go.
Sounds good.
Then, that's your call as a board.
If we're all agreeable to that.
Yep.
Any other business?
So you said that's a 10th of
That's the 10th, yeah, the second Thursday is the 10th of January. And then we can make a vote on that again in the December meeting. I have one, not a business, but just on the agenda item I'm going to place on next month is this campus. I'm with the committee with our HR department, Human Resources Department, is investigating this be a county property, parks, and this campus be smoke-free. And that process has begun, and then we're already talking about how that be phased in and a timeline. So I want to share some of that with you at the December meeting. I just wanted to call your attention to that, because that's certainly going to be something that I'll be coming back, we'll be discussing about the timeline with regard to how we're going to implement that in the parks.
Okay. Anything else? Anyone?
So that include it in the cars as well?
You know, that's going to be part of the discussion, what we're doing now is we're looking at a lot of other jurisdictions, but that's even happening here. And I think to answer your question, because it's early in the process, is most people, the enforcement is at a lower level, if that's the case, is what I'm hearing. Nobody's knocking on windows. Yeah. But really, it's property, and the car's on the property, so you know what that means.
Yeah.
But at the same time. And then I think it really then, everybody's talking about, well, then we're talking about employees, because employees then bring the risk of secondhand. So all those things, more than a constituent, a visitor, smoking in their car and then leaving it in their car. So, but those are discussions we're already having. How does that all play out, or what are the guidelines? What are the misnomers? So we're working on all that. But it's very early in the process for St. Mary's County. Because right now we're thinking notification might not even be towards the end of the spring. To let the county government and people know here is it coming, and then setting a schedule of the timeline when it's going to finally be smoke-free. And we're just in two meetings worth of discussion with different stakeholders in the county, health department and such, and others that have already implemented, such as the hospital. So that's why I want to invite you in on the discussion.
Great.
All right, I got two things if you don't mind. With the new skate park, a lot of, there was an ad hoc committee that you put together for that, for the redesign. I think we'd like to invite them to the next board meeting to get back to them, because they put a lot of time and effort into that. If that's acceptable, you know, bring them in.
I think that's a great idea.
Give them some acknowledgement and, you know.
I think it's a great idea. And we'll give you an updated status report on what, on the park.
And participation and just an overview of how it's going and everything like that.
Very good.
Then the other thing, since Jessica's not here, basketball registration opened up on the 22nd for the Recreation Parks Basketball League.
Let me say this. I know already we're 60% capacity very quickly.
People got to hurry up and get registered and get your kids signed up, or you're going to miss a spot.
Yes. And then what I was real proud of the other day, the amount of people that were coming in the door requesting scholarship and the abilities that we have. And I'll have some good news for you soon, because I like to leave you on a suspense every now and then, about a donor to the scholarship program.
Oh.
But not ready to lay that out.
But people can also donate when you register. There's a place to add to that scholarship fund, so
sure.
If you can afford to send your kid, give another couple dollars to the scholarship
Excellent
fund.
Idea, Mr. Murphy.
Well, that explains why the Rockefellers were showing up at the campus here.
Yeah.
Arthur knows them.
Yeah.
Somehow Arthur knows them.
And indoor soccer started today. Registration, I believe, for soccer started.
Oh, indoor?
So.
But that's all I had. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Each one of you, thank you. Enjoy working with you.
All right. If there's nothing else, does anyone want to move to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Adjourned.